Hello everyone, hi, welcome to the channel of Wall Street Mojo.
Watch the video till the end, and also if you are new to this channel, then you can subscribe us by clicking the bell icon.
Friends, today we are going to learn a tutorial that is on earning per share. So we are going to discuss a couple of things over here. The first is the basic EPS, the meaning, and the calculation, and so on and so forth with the examples. So let's start. See, when you analyze any a company's financial health, the very first measure that you may want to check is the profitability of the company. Absolutely. So the portion of the company's profit allocated to each outstanding share of the common stock is known as the earning per share. Now, though the interpretation of earning per share is relatively easy, however, the EPS calculation is not that simple. Like, for example, we'll have a look at the Colgate-Palmolive earning per share schedule, and let's have a look what's there. Now, this is Colgate-Palmolive Company's Notes to Consolidated Financial Statement, which has details relating to basic EPS, diluted EPS. So, we note something that there are two variations of EPS. One that is basic, another that is diluted EPS in Colgate. Also, if you note that there are stock options and restricted stock units, they are affecting the total number of shares outstanding. So, if this is slightly confusing at this stage, then you don't need to worry. The primer on the EPS cover the basic, and then you take to the advanced level of earning per share. So, we'll start with what is earning per share, and then we'll move on. At the very first stage, most commonly used corporate profitability measure for the publicly traded firms, earning per share tells a common shareholder how much the available income is associated with the share, and they own the share, that is a pie. So what are the important notes regarding EPS? You can say the first one, EPS is only reported for the shares of the common stock. Second, the non-public traded firms are not required to disclose EPS calculation. The third point, EPS provides an insight to the common shareholders about what? The future dividend payout and the value of the shareholding. So there is thing called simple versus complex capital structure. Well, we don't want to get there, but just on a slight note, I can tell you that, you know, a company's capital structure is simple if it consists of only common stock. So if it is common stock, then it is simple structure, or it includes no potential common stockholders that upon conversion or exercise could dilute the earning of the common share. And a complex capital structure has securities that could have a dilutive effect. Okay, that could have a dilutive effect on the earning per share. So this is your complex structure. These are the two structures. Now let's start with the basic EPS definition. So the basic EPS calculation does not consider the effect of any dilutive security. So there'll be no consideration over here. Here we use the actual earnings and the actual number of issued common shares. So let's understand the formula of basic EPS. Basic EPS is your net income. Once you write your net income, less your preference dividend, whatever preference dividend you pay, divide by, it's called weighted average common shareholders outstanding, or WACS, that is weighted average common shareholders, that is the number of shares outstanding. So the current year's preferred dividend is subtracted, that is the preference dividend, as we can see, is subtracted from the net income, because see, EPS refers to earning available to the common shareholders. Common stock dividends are not subtracted from the net income. Let's take some example to understand this and get into the nitty-gritty of the same. So let's take the example of Colgate. Now we'll be taking Colgate's example. Colgate has a complex capital structure. Why? Because absolutely there must be some dilutive security. Reason is that the capital structure contains stock options, so which are dilutive, and restrictive stock units that may increase the number of shares outstanding. So your denominator will get affected. And if the number of share outstanding increases, it's a simple rule, the EPS has to decrease, provided the net income remaining the same. So in this case, Colgate's number of shares outstanding due to stock options and the restricted stock units is 9.1 million for the year 2014. The basic look at this, 2.41. Dilutive is 2.38. So because of the restricted stock units, that is 9.1, the basic EPS is getting reduced to 2.38, which is your dilutive EPS. So let's take a common example of Colgate, how the EPS has been calculated. The net income of 2013 attributable to the common stockholders is 2241 million, okay, of Colgate. And the common shares outstanding is 930 million. EPS calculation of Colgate is quite easy. 2241 is your income divided by the number of shares. That will give you your EPS 2.41, which we just discussed a few minutes before. So this is how your basic EPS has been calculated. Let's take another example and get into the same. Let's say there is a company called Albatross Inc. in 2007, which has a net income of close enough to $1 million. It's $1 lakh. And the additional data that is available is 1 lakh shares of Class A, preference cumulative shares, dividend amounting to 2 per share. There's Class B of 50,000 shares, which is non-cumulative, dividend amounting to 1.5, and no dividend declared or paid in the current year. So what will be the numerator or basic EPS that we are talking about? So let's see the calculation, how things have been done. The numerator of EPS is your net income less the preference dividend. So net income is $1 lakh. The amount attributable to Class A shareholders, that is over here, as we saw, it's 2 per share. So 2 lakh. And amount attributable to Class B. So Class B shares are non-cumulative. So there is no obligation on that end with no dividend declared for the year. So no amount is deducted from the net income. So net incomes, net income comes down to $8 lakh. And the weighted average shares. Now the weighted average shares on 1st January was 1 lakh. Then on April 1st, 20,000 shares were been issued. Okay. There were other details like 1st June, 30,000 shares was issued. On October, 50,000. And on 31st December, final year and end balance was 1 lakh 40. So let's go down and see how things have been calculated. So 1 lakh shares was till 31st of March was outstanding for three months. So the weighted average shares is 25,000. Then the number of outstanding is shares are getting to 1,20,000 because new shares have been added, that is 20,000. So 1,20,000 shares outstanding for 2 months from 1st April to 31st of May. So those number of weighted shares is 20,000. For 1st June, as you can see, 1st June to 30th September, the new shares were issued, that is on first 30,000 shares were repurchased. So in case of repurchase, the shares will reduce. So in accordance to that, for 4 months, the weighted average number of shares is 30,000. And from in final, 50,000 new shares were issued, which will give us the weighted average shares as 35,000. So the new shares have been added, 90 plus 50, 1,40,000 for 3 months, 35,000, which gives the final weighted average number of shares as 1,10,000. So if you just divide the net income divided by 1,10,000, that will give your final EPS. Now the final concept that I want to take you is that how earning per share is related to the stock market. See, earning represents the profitability of the company and is considered to be the most important indicator of the financial health of the company. Earnings are reported 4 times a year by the public listed companies. And we note that, you know, the research analysts and the investor closely follow the earnings seasons. So growing earning or EPS is a measure of company's great performance and in a way a measure of return for the investors. In fact, EPS is directly related to the stock markets by the way of wide trackled Wall Street PE multiple or price by EPS ratio. So lower the PE multiple compared to the industry average, better it is from the point of view of the view of the investments and the valuation. So the stock prices react sharply to the quarterly earnings due to the very same connection. For example, over here, as you can see, is the share price movement of BlackBerry Limited. If you heard about BlackBerry long time ago, after the quarterly earnings report. If you note over here, the sharp movements in the stock prices are there over here. There is a drastic movement in the stock prices post the earning report. See the level of the fluctuations right over here.
So that's it for this particular topic. If you have learned and enjoyed watching this video, please like and comment on this video and subscribe to our channel for the latest updates. Thank you, everyone. Cheers.